everyone. Hope you are doing good in studies and in other areas of your life as well. Although you hear this every day, but working hard will definitely help you in getting the job of your choice. I'm sure you'd be aware that a variety of job choices are available to us. For example, agriculture, manufacturing, trade, transport, medical, engineering, administration, etc. These activities help us to earn money, due to which they are called economic activities. Economic activities can be broadly classified into three main categories. They are primary activities, secondary activities, and tertiary activities. Let us know about each type of activity in detail. The first one is primary activities. From the word primary, you can get the idea that these activities are earliest in order. In other words, you can say that since the beginning of civilization, people are involved in these activities. For example, fishing, mining, farming, gathering, etc. If you go in depth, you will find one thing is common in these activities. What is that? That is the extraction and production of natural resources. In all these activities, people withdraw the resources that are found in nature, such as fishes, minerals, different types of crops, etc., and sell them in the market in order to earn money. Thus, you can say primary activities deal with the extraction and production of natural resources. Hope you got my point. Now come to the secondary activities. As I just explained to you, that there are a number of things that are taken out from nature, but all the natural products are not used directly. Rather, they are converted into useful goods. The people who are involved in converting and modifying natural resources into useful products are said to work under the secondary sector, and their work is called secondary activities. For example, manufacturing of cloth from cotton, sugar from sugarcane, and steel from iron ore. Now come to the third one, that is tertiary activities. Tertiary activities help in the development of the primary and secondary sectors. These activities by themselves do not produce a good, but they are an aid or support in the production process. For example, the clothes that are made in industries need to be transported to the market. Here, the tertiary sector plays an important role by providing transportation service. Tertiary activities consist of all service occupations, such as transport, communication, trade, health, education, and administration. I hope it is clear to you. Now let us go back to primary activity, because in this chapter you have to study mainly about agriculture. That is a primary activity. The word agriculture is derived from the Latin words ager or agri, meaning soil, and culture meaning cultivation. Thus, agriculture is an art and science which deals with the cultivation of crops and domestication of animals. Similar to agriculture, we have sericulture, pisciculture, viticulture, and horticulture. But these terms have different meanings. Let us understand them one by one. Sericulture or silk farming is the cultivation of silkworms to produce silk for commercial purposes. Whereas pisciculture or fish farming involves raising fish in specially constructed tanks and ponds. Viticulture is the cultivation of grapes on a large scale. And horticulture is the agriculture of vegetables, flowers, and fruits for commercial use. I hope you got the meaning of all the terms. So children, let us end today's class here. In the next video, we will continue with the factors influencing the agriculture of an area. Do subscribe to my channel and get notifications about upcoming videos. Thank you everyone. Hello everyone. Hope you are doing good. In today's video, we are going to cover two important topics. The first one is factors influencing agricultural activities, and the second one is farm system. So let us start our today's class. But before that, I would like you to know that more than half of the world's population is directly or indirectly involved in agricultural activities. Thus, it becomes very important for us to know what influences the development of agricultural activities. Am I right? The development of agricultural activities depends on various natural and man-made factors. Let us discuss these factors in detail. Natural factors. Natural factors include relief, soil, water, and climate. Relief plays a significant role in agricultural activities. We all know flat and low lands are more suitable for agriculture as compared to high land. This is because in the hilly areas, soil is less fertile and the problem of soil erosion is high. Whereas flat land with a thick layer of fertile soil is more suitable for the growth of a variety of crops. Similarly, the availability of water is also essential for the growth of plants. Last, but not the least, is climate, which exerts the greatest control over the arable land of the world. What does the arable land mean? Arable land means the land on which crops are grown. It has been observed that suitable climatic conditions such as adequate temperature and rainfall help in the growth of crops. Let us have a look at the world map. Here you can see that agricultural growths are concentrated in those areas of the world where suitable factors for the growth of crops exist. Now, let us know about man-made factors. They are machines, fertilizers, labor, market, and transport. All these play a vital role in the development of agricultural production. I hope this is clear to you. Now let us know about farm system. Farm system is simply the way a farmer makes use of resources available for agriculture. It includes inputs, processes, and outputs. Inputs mean all the things that are required to do agriculture. For example, seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, machinery, labor, sunshine, rainfall, adequate temperature, soil, etc. These are called farm inputs. These inputs can be classified into human and physical farm inputs. Storage labor, machinery, and chemicals are procured by human beings, thus called human inputs. Whereas sunshine, rainfall, temperature, soil, and slopes are provided by nature and are called physical inputs. All these are essential to perform the agricultural activity. Now the next step is to use these inputs in order to get output. That is called processes. In other words, you can say processes are the actions within the farm that allow the inputs to turn into outputs. It includes sowing seeds, spraying pesticides, irrigating field, weeding, and harvesting. Then finally we get outputs in the form of agricultural products such as crops, wool, dairy, and poultry products. I hope this much is clear to you. In the next video, we will continue with types of farming. Do subscribe to my channel and get notifications about upcoming videos. Thank you everyone. Hello everyone. In this video, I am going to explain about different types of farming and their features. So let us start our today's class. As you know, farming is practiced all over the world. But you would be surprised to know that the ways of farming are different. The farming activity of an area depends on several factors, such as geographical conditions, the demand for produce, labor, and level of technology. Geographical conditions mean soil type, temperature, and rainfall of the area. For instance, rice is grown in an area where heavy rainfall takes place, whereas wheat is grown in the area of moderate rainfall. The demand for the produce is also not the same in every area. For example, in West Bengal, people prefer to eat rice, due to which rice is the main crop grown there. Another factor that affects agriculture is labor. As you know, to grow some crops, we need more labor. For example, tea, coffee, etc. Thus, they are grown in the area where labor is easily available. The next factor is the level of technology. It is very obvious that if we use a high level of technology or modern machinery, we can get huge production, whereas simple tools and techniques can fetch very low productivity. Thus, we can conclude that the farming activity of an area depends upon the geographical conditions, the demand for produce, labor, and level of technology. On this basis, we have classified farming into two main types. These are subsistence farming and commercial farming. Let us know about subsistence farming first. From the word subsistence, you can get the idea that this type of farming is done mainly for the existence or survival of the farmers and their family members. In other words, you can say that agricultural products are mainly consumed by the farmers and their family members. Let us know the main features of this type of farming. First, it is done on a small piece of land by using simple tools such as hoe, dough, and digging sticks. Second, as they use low levels of technology to grow a variety of crops, they do not have large produce or extra produce to sell in the market and get profit. Therefore, farmers are generally poor. Subsistence farming can be further classified into intensive subsistence farming and primitive subsistence farming. In intensive subsistence farming, the farmers cultivate a small plot of land using simple tools and more labor. It is also known as labor-intensive farming because a large number of people work on a small piece of land. Thus, it is mainly done in the thickly populated areas of the monsoon regions of South, Southeast, and East Asia. Do you know what are the main features of intensive farming? Let me tell you some features. First, in this type of farming, high yielding variety of seeds, modern chemical inputs, and irrigation are used to increase production. Second, more than one crop is cultivated during a year. For example, rice, wheat, maize, etc. Third, per hectare yield is very high. I hope all these points are clear to you. Now come to the primitive subsistence farming. It includes shifting cultivation and nomadic herding. Let us discuss each one of them in detail. Shifting cultivation is mainly practiced in the forested areas of Amazon basin, tropical Africa, Southeast Asia, and parts of Northeast India. In this type of farming, the land is cleared by cutting and burning trees, due to which it is also known as slash and burn agriculture. The farming methods are of primitive type, meaning that simple tools and techniques are used for cultivation. The crops like maize, potatoes, and cassavas are grown here. After about 2 to 3 years, when the soil loses its fertility and becomes unproductive, then the farmers shift to another part of the forest. This type of shifting allows nature to replenish the fertility of the soil through natural processes. Do you know shifting cultivation is considered a wasteful form of agriculture? But why? There are many reasons. First, it leads to deforestation because trees are cut down and burnt so that the land could be cleared to do agriculture. Second, due to deforestation, soil becomes loose, which causes soil erosion and even landslides. Third, it also causes an increase in the amount of carbon dioxide in that area because the trees are burnt. Thus, we can say it is destructive for nature. I hope this is clear to you. Now, let us know about nomadic herding. You must have studied about nomads. Nomads are a group of people who travel from one place to another and have no permanent home. These nomads move with their cattle and herds, which is called nomadic herding. But why do they move? There are many reasons for it. First, in search of water and fodder for their animals. Second, in response to climatic constraints such as inadequate and poor rainfall distribution, high temperature, and high evaporative demands, etc. They usually follow a defined route, or you can say a fixed route. It is practiced in the semi-arid and arid regions of Sahara, Central Asia, and some parts of India like Rajasthan and Jammu and Kashmir. Sheep, camel, yak, and goats are most commonly reared. They provide milk, meat, wool, hides, and other products to the herders and their families. So children, that was all about subsistence farming. In the next video, we will continue with commercial farming. Do subscribe to my channel and get notifications about upcoming videos. Thank you everyone. Hello everyone. Hope you are doing good and enjoying learning through my videos. In my previous video, you studied about different types of farming and the crops grown. Now, let us classify crops into different categories on the basis of their use. The first one is food crops, which are used as food. For example, wheat, rice, maize, etc. The second one is fiber crops, which are used in industries as raw materials, such as jute and cotton. The third one is beverage crops, like tea and coffee. All these crops are essential to meet our needs. Thus, there is a need to plan the agricultural activity in such a way that maximum output could be obtained. And it is possible only if we have knowledge of geographical conditions that are required for the growth of each crop. So let us know the climatic conditions and soil type required for the growth of these crops and the area where they are produced. Rice. Rice is a major food crop. It needs high temperature, high humidity, and rainfall. It grows best in alluvial clayey soil which can retain water. China is the leading producer of rice, followed by India, Japan, Sri Lanka, and Egypt. Next is wheat. It requires moderate temperature and rainfall during the growing season and bright sunshine at the time of harvest. It grows best in a well-drained loamy soil. Wheat is grown in the USA, Canada, Argentina, Russia, and India. In India, it is grown in the winter season. Now come to millet. Coarse grains like jowar, bajra, and ragi are called millet. It is a hardy crop that needs low rainfall and high to moderate temperatures. It can be grown on less fertile and sandy soil. The main millet producing countries are India, China, Nigeria, and Niger. Next is maize. It requires moderate temperature, rainfall, and lots of sunshine. It needs well-drained, fertile soils. It is mainly grown in North America, Brazil, China, Russia, Canada, and India. Now let us know about cotton. Cotton requires high temperature, light rainfall, 210 frost-free days, and bright sunshine for its growth. It grows best in black and alluvial soil. The main producing countries are China, USA, India, Pakistan, and Brazil. Now come to jute. Jute is also known as golden fiber. It requires high temperatures, heavy rainfall, and a humid climate. It grows well on alluvial soil. India and Bangladesh are the leading producers of jute. Next is coffee. coffee requires a warm and wet climate. It grows best in well-drained, loamy soil. Brazil is the leading producer, followed by Colombia and India. The last one is tea. Tea is a beverage crop grown on plantation. It requires a cool climate and well-distributed high rainfall throughout the year for the growth of its tender leaves. It needs well-drained, loamy soils and gentle slopes. Kenya, India, China, Sri Lanka produce the best quality tea in the world. So children, now you are aware of the geographical conditions that are required for the growth of different food and non-food crops. In the next video, we will continue with agricultural development. Do subscribe to my channel and get notifications about upcoming videos. Thank you, everyone. Hello, everyone. Do you know it takes lots of time and effort to develop the content to make an interesting video? But I'm glad that you like watching my videos, which is helping in the growth of my channel. Development in any area is possible if we make wise plans and put sincere efforts to implement them. You can take the example of agricultural sector, which has shown incredible development since last many years. But how could this be possible? In order to achieve agricultural development, many changes have been introduced in the system of farming, such as increasing the land under cultivation, growing more than one crop in a year, improving irrigation facilities, using high variety of seeds, using organic and chemical fertilizers, mechanization of agriculture, etc. All these help in increasing the farm production, which is the main aim of agricultural development. In other words, we can say that the ultimate aim of agricultural development is to increase food security. What is food security? Food security exists when all people at all times have access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food that meet their dietary needs for an active and healthy life. In simple words, you can say that the availability of food to all people at an affordable price is known as food security. Individuals who are food secure do not live in hunger or fear of starvation. Do you know, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations identified the four pillars of food security as availability, access, utilization, and stability. The United Nations recognized the right to food in the Declaration of Human Rights in 1948 and has since said that it is vital for the enjoyment of all other rights. Isn't it a remarkable decision of the UN? So children, let us end today's class here. We'll see you in the next video. Do subscribe to my channel and get notifications about upcoming videos. Thank you, everyone.